From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice.
Hello, and welcome to our listeners around the world to this JAMA Clinical Reviews podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Karen Lasser, Professor of Medicine at Boston University and Senior Editor at JAMA. Today, I am joined by Dr. Ian DeBoer, who is a professor of medicine at the University of Washington. Welcome, Dr. DeBoer.
Thank you for having me on the podcast.
So your review covers the diagnosis and management of chronic kidney disease in people with diabetes. To begin with, can you define CKD and give our listeners an overview of the epidemiology?
Of course. So diabetes is the most common cause of chronic kidney disease, which I'll refer to as CKD, and it's defined primarily by estimated GFR and albuminuria. So we measure creatinine in the blood and use equations to estimate GFR from age, sex, and serum creatinine concentration, and generally define CKD as an eGFR less than 60 mL per minute. And for albuminuria, it's most easily assessed by measuring urine albumin creatinine in a spot or random urine sample and looking at the ratio, and 30 milligrams of albumin per gram of creatinine or more is defined as CKD. Now, it's important to note that these abnormalities can be present temporarily quite frequently, and that persistence of the abnormalities is important to making a CKD diagnosis. And it's also important to note that there are other ways that CKD can be diagnosed through radiology examinations, abnormal urine sediment, for example. But most commonly, we're talking about low eGFR or elevated urine albumin as a cause of chronic kidney disease. What is the epidemiology? Well, CKD is present in about a third of people with diabetes, type 1 diabetes or type 2 diabetes, and the lifetime cumulative incidence is about 40%. So it is a very common complication of diabetes. It's more common in people who have high hemoglobin and A1C or poor glycemic control, hypertension, and there are other risk factors for chronic kidney disease as well.
Now, how should we screen for CKD in patients with diabetes, and when should we initiate screening? And how often should patients be screened?
It's really very easy to screen or test or case find for chronic kidney disease. It requires two tests. One is the eGFR and the other one is the albuminuria evaluation. And the eGFR simply calculated from serum creatinine concentration and the albuminuria measured in a spot urine sample. And in practice, we're actually quite good at getting eGFR values. They're routine lab components of common panels of chemistries, and most patients with diabetes get them regularly as part of care. We're not quite as good at measuring albuminuria, and it is important to measure both. Guidelines recommend measuring both at least annually, starting at the diagnosis of type 2 diabetes when CKD may already be present, or starting 5 years after the diagnosis of type 1 diabetes.
And in patients with diabetes, when should clinicians consider causes of CKD other than diabetes?
That's a great question. And both diabetes and CKD are common. And so when they occur together, we usually assume that they're causally related, but they certainly may not be. And we know from biopsy series, for example, that not all people with diabetes who have chronic kidney disease have CKD due to diabetes. So when should we expect that the CKD is due to something else? Well, one abnormality that should suggest looking further is abnormalities in the urinary sediment. So diabetes can cause some hematuria or red blood cells in the urine, but usually this is a minor feature. And other features like abnormal casts in the urine are not usually considered part of diabetes presentation. Also, if there's a large and sudden change in the manifestations of chronic kidney disease, for example, a quick drop or acute change in the pattern of eGFR over time, or a rapid rise in albuminuria to very high levels, those could be signs of a different chronic kidney disease cause. And finally, if people have comorbidities that are assessed in the history that may also cause chronic kidney disease, that deserves attention as well. So people who have a malignancy, for example, or lupus, those patients should have a search for other causes of chronic kidney disease other than diabetes that might require a different treatment to manage the chronic kidney disease. In general, when those factors are excluded, we make a clinical diagnosis of chronic kidney disease attributed to diabetes, sometimes called diabetic kidney disease, And that's usually as far as we need to go.
Now, how can patients with diabetes prevent CKD?
That's great, because we would love to not have to worry about chronic kidney disease in this high-risk population at all. And in fact, chronic kidney disease is preventable, or at least reducible. And the keys to that are glycemic control, first and foremost. And we know from long-term studies in both type 1 and type 2 diabetes, the DCCT EDIC study in type 1 diabetes, the UKPDS and others in type 2 diabetes, that preventing chronic kidney disease can be accomplished by controlling glycemia intensively, particularly early in the course of diabetes. Now, some people who have excellent glycemic control will still go on to get chronic kidney disease, but that risk can be markedly reduced, probably up to about half, by good glycemic control early on. What else can be done? Chronic kidney disease is in some ways a vascular disease. It shares many risk factors with cardiovascular disease, for example. And so all elements of cardiovascular health probably will help prevent chronic kidney disease as well. That includes good physical activity, maintenance of body weight, et cetera. So while we don't have great data on those interventions, probably they'll help prevent chronic kidney disease too. And some of the newer medications that I suspect we'll talk about shortly here also probably prevent chronic kidney disease in addition to treating chronic kidney disease.
So you've touched on this a bit with the last question, but when a patient with diabetes develops CKD, what lifestyle modifications should be implemented if the patient is not engaged in them already?
So we do know that there are some lifestyle interventions that'll help. So low sodium diets, for example, less than 2 grams per day of sodium, will reduce the risk of heart failure, help control hypertension, and that's recommended. And we do recommend in general 150 minutes of physical activity per week. That's consistent with the American Heart Association, and again, focused largely on reducing cardiovascular risk. There's also been a lot of interest in diet for chronic kidney disease, and there's a lot out there in terms of guidelines and opinions, many of them not evidence-based. And in fact, we don't have any evidence that reducing protein, for example, something that's been talked about a lot, has any positive impact on preventing CKD progression. And so most guidelines now are recommending a normal protein diet, about 0.8 grams of protein per kilogram of body weight, which is the World Health Organization recommendation for protein intake worldwide. In other words, really no change or need to change protein in the diet.
And I think your review also mentioned smoking cessation and weight management.
Yeah, good points. And smoking cessation is key. I almost take it for granted, but it shouldn't be taken for granted, and it's something we should address with our patients. There are observational data suggesting that smoking is associated with increased risk of kidney failure. And of course, smoking is an established risk factor for cardiovascular disease. So absolutely, smoking cessation is important, and probably also weight management. Weight management is complicated in chronic kidney disease because at the advanced stages of chronic kidney disease, there's a spontaneous reduction in caloric intake, and we worry about muscle wasting, cachexia, and malnutrition. But certainly earlier in the stages of chronic kidney disease, weight control is probably important for reducing both kidney and cardiovascular risk.
Now, in conjunction with these lifestyle modifications that we've been talking about, what pharmacologic therapies should be initiated?
This is a really exciting time for chronic kidney disease because we do have pharmacologic agents that work. And that's a change from just 10 years ago when we really only had renin-angiotensin system inhibitors. But now there's a whole new group of medications that successfully and effectively reduce cardiovascular and kidney risk in this population. So where to start? Well, I can start with renin-angiotensin system inhibitors, I suppose. And those have been around for a while. They're a cornerstone of therapy. Why? Well, for people who have chronic kidney disease and diabetes with albuminuria, albuminuria is a strong risk factor for CKD progression, and renin-angiotensin system inhibitors will reduce that risk. So for 2 decades now, we've been recommending RAS inhibitors for people who have diabetes, type 1 diabetes or type 2 diabetes, and albuminuria and hypertension as a first-line agent to treat their hypertension and reduce their kidney risk. And that remains the case. What's new are the diabetes or glucose-lowering medications that have come on the scene since renin-angiotensin system inhibitors. And those include SGLT2 inhibitors, GLP-1 receptor agonists, and the new nonsteroidal mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist, finerenone. And all three of those drugs have been shown to reduce risks of CKD progression and cardiovascular events. And so really are key components of treatment to reduce risk and improve outcomes for people with diabetes and CKD.
Yes. And I just wanted to clarify one point for our listeners, which is when you mentioned renin-angiotensin system inhibitors or RAS inhibitors, we're talking about the angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, ACE inhibitors, or the angiotensin II receptor blockers, the ARBs. And would you say that clinicians should start the SGLT2Is even when the A1C is at goal?
Yes, absolutely. So SGLT2 inhibitors are probably the new cornerstone of therapy for people with type 2 diabetes and chronic kidney disease. And I should specify type 2 diabetes. There's definitely interest in SGLT2 inhibitors for type 1 diabetes, but they are not recommended yet because of the risk of diabetic ketoacidosis in that population. They're still under evaluation. There are trials going on. But in type 2 diabetes, that risk of diabetic ketoacidosis is quite low. In an absolute sense, about 0.3% of patients or less will get diabetic ketoacidosis. And the benefits are overwhelming. So we know that SGLT2 inhibitors compared to placebo in now about 13 landmark clinical trials reduce the risk of CKD progression and kidney failure by 30 to 40%. They reduce risks of heart failure by a large amount. They reduce cardiovascular death and all-cause mortality. So they really are quite incredible drugs with marked clinical benefits in the type 2 diabetes population. And because people with type 2 diabetes and CKD are at high risk of all of these adverse clinical events, they derive a very large absolute risk reduction when treated with SGLT2 inhibitors. This seems to be completely independent of glycemia. The mechanism of benefit of SGLT2 inhibitors is not through blood glucose reduction, and the clinical benefits are present regardless of the level of glycemia at baseline, including normal glycemia. And in fact, SGLT2 inhibitors have been observed to be effective in people without diabetes as well. So what we recommend in our article and what guidelines recommend in their publications is for people with type 2 diabetes and chronic kidney disease of any manifestation, either low EGFR or albuminuria, that an SGLT2 inhibitor be included in their care to reap these benefits.
And when do you think about adding the glucagon-like peptide 1 receptor agonists, the GLP-1 receptor agonists?
Yeah, GLP-1 receptor agonists. And there are now new drugs coming too that are multiple agonists, for example, GLP-1 and GIP agonists, are really a hot topic right now. And I think their use is evolving. So what do we know about GLP-1 receptor agonists? Well, first, they're very potent glucose-lowering drugs. They help control weight, as the lay press is well aware of. And they're also good at preventing cardiovascular events, specifically atherosclerotic cardiovascular events. There was some good circumstantial evidence that they also helped prevent chronic kidney disease progression. And that was the basis of the FLOW trial, which was just published earlier this year. And the FLOW trial was a phase 3 trial of people with type 2 diabetes who had CKD defined by albuminuria, placebo-controlled, and showed that semaglutide, which is a GLP-1 receptor agonist, reduced the risk of CKD progression. So now we can add a fourth benefit to GLP-1 receptor agonists: glucose lowering, weight, cardiovascular disease, and prevention of CKD progression. So guidelines right now do prioritize GLP-1 receptor agonists for some patients with type 2 diabetes, including those with chronic kidney disease. Exactly how they should be entered into an algorithm, factored in with RAS inhibitors and SGLT2 inhibitors, is not entirely clear at this time. Certainly, I think there's consensus that for people whose individualized glycemic goals are not attained with SGLT2 inhibitors, perhaps metformin, that a GLP-1 receptor agonist should be the treatment of choice. But there are probably other indications and other groups of people with type 2 diabetes who should have this used based on their weight, their cardiovascular risk, and their CKD risk. It's an evolving area.
When should clinicians think about adding the nonsteroidal MRAs such as finerenone to the regimen?
So finerenone has also been studied in at least a couple of landmark clinical trials showing that it, when added to other treatments, including a RAS inhibitor and probably in a complementary way to SGLT2 inhibitor, reduces risks of CKD progression and heart failure for this class of drugs. So the magnitude of risk reduction is not quite the same as that seen with SGLT2 inhibitors or perhaps GLP-1 receptor agonists, but it is certainly a welcome addition that can further reduce risk of these outcomes. Who should use it? Well, finerenone was studied in the trials for people who had type 2 diabetes and albuminuria, and they had albuminuria despite treatment with other drugs. So we call this residual albuminuria. The albuminuria was not suppressed through treatment with the other drugs. These patients would be at high risk of cardiovascular disease and chronic kidney disease progression. And in that group, we have evidence that those risks are indeed reduced. So guidelines follow the eligibility for the trial, and our recommendations in the paper also follow those eligibility criteria. So people who are already treated with a RAS inhibitor, an SGLT2 inhibitor, maybe a GLP-1 receptor agonist, who still have albuminuria as a risk indicator, can have a nonsteroidal mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist added. And really, right now, the only one approved in the United States is finerenone. So that's what we're talking about. Now, there are side effects to finerenone, mainly hyperkalemia and acute kidney injury. And so selecting the right patient also entails looking at their serum potassium level, the risk of acute kidney injury, and monitoring those patients to diagnose, assess, and see hyperkalemia and moderate that if needed.
And finally, is there anything else generalists should know about diabetes and chronic kidney disease that we haven't talked about?
I think I'd like to end by reinforcing the need for screening, also testing, case finding, whatever it's called, because identifying patients with chronic kidney disease is now key. We have treatments, we need to find them. And in particular, it's the albuminuria screening that people tend to forget about. The testing, at least yearly, for people with type 1 and type 2 diabetes with both EGFR and albuminuria is critical. When we find these people, we now have a whole host of new medications that we can use to make their lives better. So in primary care, I really feel that awareness of chronic kidney disease, testing for chronic kidney disease is key. And then that's the beginning of a cascade that we can use to enhance treatments and improve longevity, improve outcomes for people with both type 1 and type 2 diabetes.
Well, thank you. This has been tremendously helpful. I'm Dr. Karen Lasser. I've been speaking today with Dr. Ian DeBoer from University of Washington about diabetes and chronic kidney disease. You can find a link to the article in this episode's description. This episode was produced by Daniel Musisi at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.